Colonel Sikes was also involved in the formulation of propaganda and linking unwantedness with Jewishness and things of that nature, working for Augsburg.
So what we have here, we have Sikes, Augsburg, and Akmatelli all involved with the so-called Jewish section, the S4 section. In other words, all three of the men who worked for the special forces were involved in basically executing, and I guess the term could be used advisedly, Hitler's policy against the Jews. And these are the same three who went to work first forming the special forces.
Okay. Now, the question is what happened? I mean, weren't these people all, you know, going to prison for war crimes? I mean, you know, they were involved in the Final Solution. They were involved in the slaughter of hundreds of people, as Sikes was at Smolensk. You know, what happened? Well, here's a very partial example of the kinds of things that happened. This is from the Belarus Secret by John Loftus. John Loftus, by the way, is was a U.S. government official who happened to stumble onto the Bielorussian Nazi situation of our importation of Bielorussian Nazis into the United States and into U.S. Intelligence circles, and which got him a little irked, I suppose, and led him to do the research that led to this book. So once again, this is from the Belarus Secret, B-E-L-A-R-U-S, by John Loftus, copyright 1982, Alfred A. Knopf. And Loftus writes as follows. Galen suggested that Wisner, that's Frank Wisner, the American, hire Dr. Franz Sikes to head the recruitment and training of the Special Forces, the Green Berets. Sikes knew most of the leading Bielorussians, he explained, having recruited them for Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of Russia. Sikes, however, was at that moment on trial for his crimes at Nuremberg. Wisner asked General Clay to intercede with the Nuremberg prosecutor and judges. Whether Clay took such action is unknown, but Sikes received only a 20-year prison term, while the rest of the Einsatzgruppen and commanders were sentenced to death. In 1950, Clay's successor, High Commissioner John J. McCloy, commuted the sentence to time served, and Sikes went to work for Galen on the Special Forces project. Now, some people out there could make the case that it was merely a coincidence that everybody else who was up for trial received the death sentence, and that Sikes only got a 20-year prison term, and that in 1950 John McCloy came in and just happened to commute his sentence to time served, and that the person who was the, if not admitted, at least testified to murder of hundreds of people, himself personally responsible in Smolensk and also involved in the Nazi racial legislation and the Final Solution and things of that nature. Well, I suppose the case could be made, you'd have a long way to go in making it, that was a coincidence.
Now recall that John McCloy is a name that we've seen before. We looked at him in the very first part of the broadcast. He was Hitler's personal guest at the 1936 Olympics, okay, so certainly he was no stranger to Third Reich personnel. He was, again, Hitler's personal guest at the 36 Olympics. He then became Under Secretary of War and specifically was regarded in that capacity as Secretary of War, now it's called the Secretary of Defense, Secretary of War Henry Stimson's leg man, so to speak. He did a lot of the schlepping, I guess you might say, for Henry Stimson, and was regarded as being, for all intents and purposes, in effective control of U.S. military policy during World War II. He landed with the troops in North Africa and was, as I say, instrumental in administering U.S. wartime policy. And as we saw in North Africa, our landings there, that is to say, American and Allied landings, were aided by a group of Jews, Democrats, and Socialists in French North Africa, who then, once they had helped the Americans achieve a relatively bloodless landing, were then promptly interned by the very French fascists, the very Vichy French, who were supposedly our enemies, who were then put right back in power in French North Africa. And coincidentally, the Vichy French industrialists, the French fascist industrialists, along with the German Die Trust cartel IG Farben, transferred massive amounts of funds into North Africa, which were then safely stashed away, so to speak, in anticipation of the collapse of the Reich. The same policy of reinstituting the fascists we then saw in Italy and in Greece as well. So John McCloy is a name that we've seen before. And keep in mind his springing, I guess you might say, of Franz Alfred Sikes from the defendant's dock at Nuremberg, because we're going to be looking at John J. McCloy's reinstitution of Nazi war criminals and Nazis in general again in a few minutes.
Now, okay, again, now we're on the subject of these people, specifically these three men who became the molding force of the Special Forces. Again, we are talking about people, and I made the point earlier that to be in the SD, to be involved with the SD, you had to be a diehard Nazi. Now, for those of you, again, who are perhaps of an age or of an experiential level, I guess you could say, where you're not that familiar with Nazi ideology, okay, it's not simply to dress up in uniforms, to march around, you know, and, of course, and then all the Jews got killed. I mean, that's sort of the shorthand that you hear these days. We're talking about a group of people who literally, their literal credo was to rule the world, okay? These people were planning to rule the entire world and remake it in their image. Now, if you want to, I mean, it's a type of insanity, but these people were insane en masse, and they had huge military armaments to back them up. And they had plans for everybody once they had conquered these countries. They were not merely going to conquer them as armies had in the past, exact some tribute, and withdraw back to their boundaries. No, this was a plan for world domination, and people like Franz Alfred Sieks were in fact slated to play a key role.
Another interesting point to make in that same context is the fact that the Nazis were extremely clever in parlaying their anti-communism, and they were fiercely anti-communist, into a device for world conquest. In other words, they wormed their way into a lot of different nests they might not otherwise have been in by representing themselves and accurately as far as it goes as anti-communists. The point is that they were far more than anti-communists. They sought to dominate the world, as Nip Tuck said, and they sought to conquer all of it. And anti-communism, in addition to being a doctrinal consideration for them, was one of their great methodological tools for conquering the world, because, as I say, they were able to lay many of their enemies into a false sense of security by saying, don't worry about us, we're good anti-communists, and then zap, right in the back.
And, of course, that is, in fact, what, as we're finding out, kept most of them in circulation at the end of World War II.
Okay, now, the events that we've been talking about concern Eastern Europe. They concern the atrocities against the Jews that, of course, the Nazis are very well known for. It may be that some people will find these events very distant and a little bit difficult to relate to. It's worth noting, as I said, that in addition to being anti-communist and anti-Semitic, the Nazis were fundamentally anti-democratic, and that goes for the SS and the SD, the Sicherheitsdienst, the SS Intelligence Service in particular. Now, to give you sort of an idea of just how fundamentally undemocratic these people are, because, you know, Eastern Europe is a long way away and the events of the Holocaust might seem very distant, we're going to give you an idea of just how undemocratic Mr. Franz Alfred Sieks, who Nip Tuck just told you about, really is. Now, interestingly enough, Sieks was the personal choice of SS Reichsfuhrer Heinrich Himmler, the infamous leader of the SS, and also SD head Reinhard Heydrich, appropriately known as the Hangman. He was their choice to head up internal security for Great Britain after the proposed Nazi conquest of Britain. I'm going to give you an idea of what Sieks had in mind for the British here. I'm about to read you a section about Sieks from a book called Gestapo. That book was authored by a man named Roger Manvell, M-A-N-V-E-L-L. This is from Ballantine's Illustrated History of World War II, issued in paperback in 1969, copyrighted in 1969. Of Herr Dr. Sieks, Mr. Manvell writes as follows. Everything which happened took place inside a dozen years, no more. In that brief space, the ruthless efficiency of the SS and its component forces, the Gestapo and the SD, spread across the greater part of Europe. The complete plan for a similar subjugation of Great Britain came to light after the war. At the head of the administration ready to move into Great Britain was SS Colonel Professor Dr. Franz Sieks. Interrupting, at this point he was only a colonel, later he became a brigadier general. At the head of the administration ready to move into Great Britain was SS Colonel Professor Dr. Franz Sieks, formerly dean of a new faculty of political science, the Faculty for Foreign Countries in the University of Berlin. Sieks was another of Himmler's intellectuals and one of Heydrich's most trusted officers. Again, Heydrich, Reinhard Heydrich, the hangman, head of the SD. The plan for Great Britain was prepared during the summer of 1940 under the title Orders Concerning the Organization and Function of Military Government in England. Able-bodied men between 17 and 45 would have been dispatched to Germany in large numbers for slave labor. Raw materials, plant, and equipment would have been plundered and removed. Behind the invading forces, Professor Sieks and his police forces would have moved in. As in Poland, the intelligentsia would have been liquidated along with the Jews. The names officially listed included H.G. Wells, Noel Coward, Bertrand Russell, J.B. Priestley, and C.P. Snow. The list of names of victims printed and full of inaccuracies survives. SS and Gestapo headquarters were to be established in London, Bristol, Birmingham, Liverpool, Manchester, and Edinburgh. So, Mr. Seeks had much, much larger plans than just getting rid of the Jews, and it's questionable whether a man like this should have been employed by the United States government.
I think questionable is a very nice term, Dave. I think that's very, very subtly put. Okay, the next section is from a book entitled Klaus Barbie, The Butcher of Lyon.
First, before we get into Klaus Barbie here, let me give you just a little idea of what Mr. Seeks did after forming the Special Forces. Now, Seeks continued to work for the Galen Organization, and he went to work in his capacity as an agent for the Galen Organization for what, at least for Mr. Seeks, was a corporate front. And you're going to encounter a very familiar name here, and keep it in mind as you recall the activities of Mr. Seeks in Augsburg and their activities against the Soviets, against the Jews, their proposed activities against such dangers to society as Noel Coward and H.G. Wells and Bertrand Russell. Now, reading now from a book called Aftermath. Aftermath was authored by a man named Ladislaus Farrago, who was a former U.S. intelligence agent. Specifically, he was in charge of operations and planning for the Special Warfare Division of U.S. Naval Intelligence during World War II. Then he worked for CIA after the war. And his book, Aftermath, about the post-war activities of many of the Third Reich veterans, was published in hardcover in 1974 by Simon & Schuster. Also, a softcover edition by Avon Press is available. And in a footnote about Dr. Seeks here, Ladislaus Farrago mentions his work for a corporate front, and again, you're going to hear a very familiar name here. On April 10th, 1949, Seeks was sentenced to 20 years in prison by an American military tribunal, but his sentence was reduced to 10 years in 1951 by General Thomas Handy, H-A-N-D-Y. He was amnestied shortly afterward by U.S. High Commissioner John J. McCloy on the recommendation of his clemency board. In 1965, Dr. Seeks was publicity and advertising manager of Porsche Diesel, a subsidiary of the huge Mannesmann company, and was consultant of the Galen Organization, quote, with special competence in Soviet matters. So next time you see a Porsche go by, remember Dr. Seeks.
Okay. Now, this is a section from the book Klaus Barbie, The Butcher of Lyon by Tom Bauer, copyright 1984. Now, something that has to be pointed out here, for those of you who are not familiar, who've been living in a hole somewhere for the last 2 years, Klaus Barbie, of course, otherwise known, as the title states, as the Butcher of Lyon, was the Gestapo chief during the French occupation of France by the Germans during World War II, obviously. He was the chief officer of Lyon, France. He is currently being held in France ostensibly for trial because of the numerous atrocities committed by himself personally and people under his command during World War II. However, as people who listen to One Step Beyond and Hard Rain are familiar with, Klaus Barbie led a very tangled and rather intricate trail at the end of World War II, much of which brought him into contact with, strangely enough, the CIA. And one of his biographers, a man named Dobringhaus, who is just about to publish a book, was in fact Barbie's contact officer with United States intelligence. And we have some fairly reliable information on Klaus Barbie working for the CIA the entire time he was in Bolivia, where he was one of the kingpins of the cocaine traffic and the coca fascista there. And the coca fascista, who used to do things like meet together in bars wearing SS uniforms and singing the Horst Wessel song, etc., etc. Okay, now Klaus Barbie shows up indeed with the same people. Again, reading from Klaus Barbie, The Butcher of Lyon by Tom Bauer. In the weeks before Operation Selection Board, Barbie had been shuttling between Marburg, Kassel, and Munich, exploring the authenticity of an alluring offer to join a new intelligence-gathering team set up by two very senior ex-SS officers, SS Brigadier General Franz Alfred Seeks and SS Colonel Emil Augsburg. Both had been directly involved in murdering thousands of Jews in Eastern Europe. Sikes had been head of Section 7 in Himmler's head office, the RSHA, the Reich Sicherheitshauptamt, and had served with extermination squads in Russia, while Augsburg, working ostensibly as an academic studying Eastern Europe at the Wannsee Institute, was in reality attached to Adolf Eichmann's S4 department, handling the Jewish question. Both were in hiding, but claimed to have been approached by American intelligence agents with an offer to collect material about the Soviet Union. Barbie was invited to join the team.
Okay, now, that couple of points about the passage Nip just read you there. The Operations Selection Board was a program set up by U.S. intelligence supposedly to gather up Nazi war criminals and, ostensibly to gather up Nazi war criminals to mete out justice to them. Now, Bauer mentions that he says that because of the fact that Dr. Sikes was arrested and Augsburg escaped, this led Klaus Barbie to shy away from this team. This cannot be taken as absolute gospel for a couple of reasons. Now, the aforementioned Erhard Dabringhaus, who was Barbie's control officer in U.S. military intelligence, the Counterintelligence Corps, has pointed out in an article, as a matter of fact, which is an excerpt from his forthcoming book in the latest issue of Penthouse, for those of you who can stomach that publication, would like to read it, it might be worth doing, has pointed out that Klaus Barbie enjoyed exactly the same status as any other German citizen. He was not monitored, no one kept him under surveillance, so we really can't say what his status was or who he worked with, because as we've seen, although Sikes was in fact arrested for war crimes, he went to work for U.S. intelligence, was put to work informing the special forces, and interestingly enough, we saw that Klaus Barbie was dispatched with the aid of the so-called rat line, including U.S. intelligence as well as the Vatican, to Latin America, and interestingly enough, according to an article currently appearing in the West German magazine Stern, Klaus Barbie, it was very much involved with the capture and killing of Che Guevara, the Cuban revolutionary, in Bolivia. And interestingly enough, that act was carried out in no small measure by special forces. So we certainly can't say that Barbie did go to work for the special forces, but the denial that he did, in fact, accept the invitation to work for the team cannot be verified, because Barbie was his own agent, and as he does crop up in later contacts with special forces, and as we've seen, Dr. Sikes' arrest was by no means the last word. Now, after the, I guess you'd call the CIA episode of the special forces, the remnants of Frank Wisner and Galen's special forces were absorbed into the U.S. Army, that in their inception they were part of the CIA, now they're part of the regular army. Now, certainly there have probably been a great many changes in that organization since that time. In no way can you infer that someone that was in the special forces is a fascist or, you know, a war criminal or anything like that. It's an important distinction to make. You never automatically equate anyone with any organization they've been in, and certainly it's an open question as to just what changes, you know, what kinds of changes the special forces have undergone in jumping from the CIA to the Army and in the 30 years' time. It is, I think, though, in light of the fact that the special forces are a very, very important organ of U.S. Foreign and military policy to this day, and, you know, the Contras and the Salvadorian forces are being trained by the Green Berets, it is at least a worthwhile question to ask, to what extent do the special forces of today reflect their SS origins?
Okay, now, this, again, is something to look at in regards to what kinds of things do the Green Berets seem to be involved in. Now, this particular source is an article in Covert Action Information Bulletin. However, I give you my personal word that there have been other allegations of this sort in many sources. This was convenient, close to hand, and pithy. However, Amnesty International, among others, has documented the allegations that have been made, numerous allegations of Green Beret involvement in these types of things. Okay, and many other sources, and including other newspaper sources. This just happened to have it condensed in one section.
Before getting into this, you're listening to KFJC Los Altos Hills, and worth noting that this is from Covert Action Information Bulletin number 16 from March of 1982.
Okay, this is from an article entitled Salvadoran Deserter Discloses Green Beret Torture Role, and this is the prelude to the article. It says, for a long time, documented reports of massacres by the Salvadoran armed forces and death squads have been commonplace. Suggestions that U.S., quote, advisors have been involved were invariably denied by the Reagan administration. But readers of the establishment press were shocked by a dispatch from Raymond Bonner in the January 11th New York Times, which placed U.S. Special Forces Green Berets at classes devised to teach methods of torture to Salvadoran soldiers. Bonner had interviewed an army deserter in Mexico City who described the classes in detail. The implications of this shift from indiscriminate killing to deliberate torture are significant. During the Vietnam War, U.S. troops and CIA, quote, police advisors regularly engaged in torture to try to obtain information. And, as the Dan Mitrione incident in Uruguay makes clear, U.S. advisors have in the past shown their clients how effective torture can be, both in obtaining information and in intimidating the population. The role of Argentina in South Africa and El Salvador, discussed elsewhere in this issue, also confirms this development in the strategy of the Salvadoran junta. Moreover, in further taped interviews with other journalists, Bonner's source, 21-year-old Carlos Antonio Gomez Montano, implicated some of the Green Berets directly in the commission of torture. These interviews were first reported in the January 1982 issue of El Salvador Alert, the publication of the Committee in Solidarity with the People of El Salvador. Covert Action Information Bulletin has obtained the transcript of the critical interview, and what follows are the portions dealing with the participation of U.S. troops. Gomez was drafted into the Salvadoran Army in December 1980 and was jailed the following April. In May, some friends helped him escape, and he spent the next several weeks traveling through El Salvador, Guatemala, and Mexico, where a refugee aid group has helped him to settle. Now, before Dave continues the article, I would just comment, as I mentioned earlier in the show, this is a rather graphic explanation of torture practices, and if you want to turn your radio down while you're not listen to it for a moment, you have been warned.
Okay, now, after a description of Gomez's basic training in El Salvador, the transcript begins. Again, this is a transcript, an interview with Gomez. So this is Gomez Montano, specifically Carlos Antonio Gomez Montano speaking here. Later, we had a welcome for the Green Beret. That day was the day of the soldier. They formed all of us up in columns. We had a homage for those who had fallen and for those still alive, too. Again, this is transcript here, so if the syntax seems a little garbled, that's what we have. They got us up for this to greet these Green Beret who came in from the U.S. The officers said they would be able to teach you a new tactic. We didn't have any idea what this new tactic was. We thought it was something else. The first time they brought us to a volcano, and they brought us to the slopes of the volcano so that we were going to combat with the guerrilla fighters. The Green Beret didn't go into combat. They were just behind teaching us how to do these things. They would criticize us as to what was good and what was bad. We passed 5 days on a volcano. There were 600 of us, in all 5,000. Of those, there were many who didn't return. There were lots of soldiers who were killed. 6 days later, we returned to the barracks, and then they began to teach us how to torture. One evening, they went and got 9 young people that were accused of being guerrillas and brought them to where we were. This was more or less the last time that I had to see very well the type of torture they carried out against the guerrillas. The first one they brought, a young fellow who was around 15 or 16 years old, and the first thing they did was to stick bayonets under his fingernails and pull them out. That day he was the first one that died under torture. This young fellow said all sorts of things against them to let him go. The officers said, "We are going to teach you how to mutilate and how to teach a lesson to these guerrillas." The officers who were teaching us this were the American Green Beret. They didn't speak Spanish, so they spoke English, and then another officer, Salvadoran, translated it into Spanish for us. Then they began to torture this young fellow. They took out their knives and stuck them under his fingernails. After they took his fingernails off, then they broke his elbows. Afterwards, they gouged out his eyes. Then they took their bayonets and made all sorts of slices in his skin, all around his chest, arms, and legs. They then took his hair off and the skin of his scalp. When they saw there was nothing left to do with him, They threw gasoline on him and burned him. The next day, his dead body wasn't around, but was found by people out in the streets, left in the street. The next day, they started the same thing with a 13-year-old girl. They did more or less the same, but they did other things to her, too. First, she was utilized, raped by all the officers. They stripped her and threw her in a small room. They went in one by one. Afterwards, they took her out, tied and blindfolded. Then they began the same mutilating, pulling her fingernails out and cutting off her fingers, breaking her arms, gouging out her eyes, and all they did to the other fellow. They cut her legs and stuck an iron rod into her womb. The last one that they killed that day suffered more because they stripped him naked at midday. There, they put him on this hot tin and made him lie there. He was like cooking. After about a half hour, when they finally took him off, he was all covered with blisters like wounds. They did different types of torture to him. Then they threw him out alive at 14,000 feet altitude from a helicopter. He was alive and tied. They go and they throw them out over the sea. Then the interviewer asks him a question. Can you give a better description of the Green Berets? Names, numbers, anything? Answer. I don't know their names, but there were eight. The officers knew. There was only one of the eight that could speak Spanish. They were all white. There were some blacks, but I don't know where they were from. The eight U.S. Green Berets that were there were all white. They dressed themselves the same as any soldier. One of them sort of gave orders, but they didn't have any indication of their rank. Question, did they rape the women too? Answer, no, they only taught. Question, did they do the fingernail pulling? Answer, it was one of the Green Berets doing the teaching. The Green Beret did the torture on the first one, and then the others did the tortures on the others. So again, as you see the headlines and the stories coming out about the atrocities in Central America, keep in mind the SS origins of the Green Beret. We're not, again, saying that this is typical of all Green Berets, and we're not certainly condemning any individual for being part of that organization, because you never, as I said, you never equate any individual with an organization that he or she belongs to. And with the special forces now, mind control is pretty much standard operating procedure, which is sort of, I guess you might call, a moral X factor. How do you judge someone who's been brainwashed into doing things? But again, as you read about what's going on in Central America, keep in mind where the Green Berets come from.
Yes, neither do you. You may not blame any individual without knowledge of his personal actions because of a group he belongs to. Neither can you turn your back on the activities of a group. Let me add one last thing before we take a quick break, which is that, again, we picked that one example. There are numerous examples. We could probably do 4 hours lying down just on allegations and fairly well-documented allegations, backup testimony, et cetera, on allegations of this type of direct American military and intelligence involvement with the fostering of torture in Central and South America. The Mitrione case mentioned there is one in which it was discovered that, among other things, needles and instruments for electrical shock were being brought into the countries of Brazil and Uruguay in the American embassy diplomatic pouch, if you can put that in your brain and hang on to that for a minute. We will be back. After a short break of about 5 or 6 minutes, we will go on with the next part of our broadcast, so don't go away. Once again, this is Nip Tuck for myself and Dave Emery, and we will return with the next section of Looking Back from 1984, The Hidden History of the Cold War, in about 5 minutes, right here on KFJC. Okay, good evening and welcome back to Radio Free America. This is Nip Tuck. I'm here in the studios at KFJC with Dave Emery. We are continuing with the second half, the second hour of the second half of Looking Back from 1984, A Hidden History of the Cold War.
Okay, now, in the last hour, we were looking at one of the Nazi war criminals that were recruited by the CIA and Reinhard Gehlen to form the Special Forces, specifically a man named Dr. Franz Alfred Sieks. Now, he was in the defendant's dock at Nuremberg for his crimes executing Jews in the Soviet Union, and he was granted clemency by U.S. High Commissioner of Germany, John J. McCloy. Okay, now, John J. McCloy had basically become, he, as we saw before the war, he was Hitler's personal guest at the Olympics, and as Undersecretary of War had a great deal to do with administering U.S. wartime policy, and after driving out the fascists, or at least nominally driving out the fascists, reinstituting the very fascist elements we were supposedly opposed to once the Germans had been driven out of these occupied areas. Now, after the war, he became U.S. High Commissioner of Germany, that is to say, he was for all intents and purposes the head of the military occupation government in Germany, and in that capacity, he proceeded not only to turn men like Dr. Seeks loose, and many, many Nazi war criminals were released, courtesy of John J. McCloy, but he also returned many of the Nazi industrialists to power, specifically Mr. Krupp, who, of course, head of the very famous Krupp armaments industry, and Alfred Krupp was among the industrialists released by John J. McCloy. Now, in the first broadcast, the first part of Looking Back from 1984, The Hidden History of the Cold War, we took a look very briefly at the formation of some of the large German cartels, which had a great deal to do not only with the financing of the Nazis' rise to power, but also with providing them with the armaments that they needed to embark on their program of world conquest. Now, briefly, we saw how the United States and other Western powers provided a series of loans, not only loans to the Weimar government, but specifically bond issues floated on the American securities market, which basically enabled the Germans to pay off the reparations debts, the very heavy reparations debts that were put upon them, instituted as a result of the Treaty of Versailles. So that kind of a financial hydraulic system was set up whereby the U.S. paid Germany and then Germany paid France and Britain. And a total of 31 billion marks was paid out by Germany, and they borrowed a total of 28 billion. So that a net payment was only made of 3 billion marks. And these loans programs were primarily accomplished under the so-called Dawes Plan and the Young Plan. And as we saw, a rising young Wall Street lawyer named John Foster Dulles, one of two senior partners along with his brother Alan Dulles, and we just saw them, you'll recall, at work with the CIA official Wisner and Reinhard Galen in promoting the special forces. The Dawes Plan was drawn up by John Foster Dulles, who was appointed as special counsel to the Dawes Committee by J.P. Morgan, John Pierpont Morgan. Now, the reparations loans were utilized by many of the companies which got them to basically buy out their competition. It put them in a superior position with regard to commercial competition, and these loans had a great deal to do with the consolidation of three large German cartels. First of all, the former loose association of the German dyestuffs industry, the so-called community of interests or Interessengemeinschaft Farben industry, became formerly one company, IG Farben, and the reparations loans, the loans provided under the Dawes and Young Plan, had a fair amount to do with the formal consolidation of what had been a loosely knit community of interests of separate companies, their formal consolidation into one company, IG Farben. The two other large cartels that grew out of this plan were the Vereinigte Stahlwerke, the so-called United Steel, and the Allgemeine Elektrizitätsgesellschaft, the AEG, the German General Electric, 30% owned by General Electric in the United States. Okay, now these cartels, as I said, not only helped provide Hitler with many of his war, in fact, they were the backbone of German war production. They also had a great deal to do with financing Hitler's rise to power. So the problem of German cartels was very much connected with the problem of denazification. And it's worth noting that these cartels wielded tremendous influence not only in Germany and the conquered nations, but all over the world. And one of the men who was charged with dealing with the international effects of these cartels, basically with attempting to blunt the international actions of these cartels in order to hamper German war production, was a man named James Stuart Martin. Now, James Stuart Martin was head of something called the Economic Warfare Section of the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice during World War II. He worked with, among others, a man named Joseph Borkin, B-O-R-K-I-N, who wrote a recent bestseller about IG Farben a few years back called The Crime and Punishment of I.G. Farben. Now, James Stewart Martin not only worked against the cartels during the war, he was head of the so-called bombing section. That's what they called his economic warfare section, because they, in addition to attempting to blunt the international affairs, the international business dealings of the cartels, which brought Nazi Germany a great deal of profit from its their foreign markets, but he also had a lot to do with advising the U.S. Army Air Force on which targets to bomb. And after the war, James Stewart Martin was very much involved with the attempt at breaking up the German cartels. Now, keep in mind that the German cartels were very much connected, because a cartel is an international monopoly, that was very much, they were very much connected with not only American, but also British, French, and other countries' industrial interests. And the breaking up of the cartels, that so-called decartelization of Germany, was a major element of denazification. Now, as we've seen, John J. McCloy returned many Nazi war criminals right back into German life. He released Alfred Krupp and some of the other industrialists, and James Stewart Martin wrote a book about his wartime experiences and post-war experiences, and that book was called All Honorable Men. And All Honorable Men was copyrighted in 1950 and published in hardcover by Little Brown and Company. And in the story of decartelization, we're going to encounter a name that we've heard before.
Okay, indeed. And you will also remember, if you listen to the first broadcast, that that self-same gentleman whose name we're talking about showed up, and he was none other than Herbert Hoover. At the time of the end of the First World War, of course, this was prior to his presidency, and at that time he was in charge of food relief for war-ravaged Europe after the end of World War I. Russia, of course, had dropped out of World War I during the time of the revolution there, the Bolshevik Revolution, and by the end of the war, the Bolsheviks were firmly in power in Russia. Now, as you also will remember, one of the main things that we talked about in regards to Herbert Hoover is how he lost millions of dollars in oil interests when the Bolsheviks nationalized the oil fields in Russia. We also mentioned the fact that Herbert Hoover, in charge of food relief, strangely enough, couldn't seem to get any of the food relief money into Bolshevik Russia, even though Bolshevik Russia had been one of the areas hardest hit by the famines that resulted from World War I. And in fact, a lot of the food relief seemed to be going to the white Russian emigre groups who were setting up to reinvade Russia and throw the Bolsheviks out and reinstall Tsarism. And that Hoover, in fact, was channeling food to these groups and to other groups such as the Poles, who were going to take advantage of people who literally, their literal credo was to rule the world. Okay, these people were planning to rule the entire world and remake it in their image. Now, if you want to, I mean, it's a type of insanity, but these people were insane en masse, and they had huge military armaments to back them up. And they had plans for everybody once they had conquered these countries. They were not merely going to conquer them as armies had in the past, exact some tribute, and withdraw back to their boundaries. No, this was a plan for world domination, and people like Franz Alfred Sieks were in fact slated to play a key role.
Another interesting point to make in that same context is the fact that the Nazis were extremely clever in parlaying their anti-communism, and they were fiercely anti-communist, into a device for world conquest. In other words, they wormed their way into a lot of different nests they might not otherwise have been in by representing themselves, and accurately as far as it goes, as anti-communists. The point is that they were far more than anti-communists. They sought to dominate the world, as Niptuck said, and they sought to conquer all of it. And anti-communism, in addition to being a doctrinal consideration for them, was one of their great methodological tools for conquering the world, because, as I say, there's North Africa, and coincidentally, the Vichy French industrialists, the French fascist industrialists, along with the German Die Trust cartel IG Farben, transferred massive amounts of funds into North Africa, which were then safely stashed away, so to speak, in anticipation of the collapse of the Reich. The same policy of reinstituting the fascists we then saw in Italy and in Greece as well. So John McCloy is a name that we've seen before. And keep in mind his springing, I guess you might say, of Franz Alfred Sieks from the defendant's dock at Nuremberg, because we're going to be looking at John J. McCloy's reinstitution of Nazi war criminals and Nazis in general again in a few minutes.
Now, okay, again, now we're on the subject of these people, specifically these three men who became the molding force of the special forces. Again, we are talking about people, and I made the point earlier that to be in the SD, to be involved with the SD, you had to be a diehard Nazi. Now, for those of you, again, who are perhaps of an age or of an experiential level, I guess you could say, where you're not that familiar with Nazi ideology, okay, it's not simply to dress up in uniforms, to march around, you know, and, of course, and then all the Jews got killed. I mean, that's sort of the shorthand that you hear these days. We're talking about a group of Knopf. And Loftus writes as follows. Galen suggested that Wisner, that's Frank Wisner, the American, hire Dr. Franz Seeks to head the recruitment and training of the Special Forces, the Green Berets. Seeks knew most of the leading Bielorussians, he explained, having recruited them for Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of Russia. Seeks, however, was at that moment on trial for his crimes at Nuremberg. Wisner asked General Clay to intercede with the Nuremberg prosecutor and judges. Whether Clay took such action is unknown, but Sieks received only a 20-year prison term, while the rest of the Einsatzgruppen commanders were sentenced to death. In 1950, Clay's successor, High Commissioner John J. McCloy, commuted the sentence to time served, and Sieks went to work for Galen on the Special Forces project. Now, some people out there could make the case that it was merely a coincidence that everybody else who was up for trial received the death sentence, and that Sieks only got a 20-year prison term, and that in 1950 John McCloy came in and just happened to commute his sentence to time served, and that the person who was the, if not admitted, at least testified to murder of hundreds of people, himself personally responsible in Smolensk and also involved in the Nazi racial legislation and the Final Solution and things of that nature. Well, I suppose the case could be made, you'd have a long way to go in making it, that was a coincidence.
Now recall that John McCloy is a name that we've seen before. We looked at him in the very first part of the broadcast. He was Hitler's personal guest at the 1936 Olympics, okay, so certainly he was no stranger to Third Reich personnel. He was, again, Hitler's personal guest at the 36 Olympics. He then became Under Secretary of War and specifically was regarded in that capacity as Secretary of War. Now it's called the Secretary of Defense. Secretary of War, Henry Stimson's leg man, so to speak. He did a lot of the schlepping, I guess you might say, for Henry Stimson and was regarded as being, for all intents and purposes, in effective control of U.S. military policy during World War II. He landed with the troops in North Africa and was, as I say, instrumental in administering U.S. wartime policy. And as we saw in North Africa, our landings there, that is to say American and Allied landings, were aided by a group of Jews, Democrats, and Socialists in French North Africa, who then, once they had helped the Americans achieve a relatively bloodless landing, were then promptly interned by the very French fascists, the very Vichy French, who were supposedly our enemies, who were then put right back in power in French.
Colonel Sieks was also involved in the formulation of propaganda and linking unwantedness with Jewishness and things of that nature, working for Augsburg.
So what we have here, we have Sieks, Augsburg, and Akmatelli all involved with the so-called Jewish section, the S4 section. In other words, all three of the men who worked for the Special Forces were involved in basically executing, and I guess the term could be used advisedly, Hitler's policy against the Jews. And these are the same three who went to work first forming the Special Forces.
Okay. Now, the question is what happened? I mean, weren't these people all, you know, going to prison for war crimes? I mean, you know, they were involved in the Final Solution. They were involved in the slaughter of hundreds of people, as Sieks was at Smolensk. You know, what happened? Well, here's a very partial example of the kinds of things that happened. This is from the Belarus Secret by John Loftus. John Loftus, by the way, was a U.S. government official who happened to stumble onto the Bielorussian Nazi situation of our importation of Bielorussian Nazis into the United States and into U.S. Intelligence circles, and which got him a little irked, I suppose, and led him to do the research that led to this book. So once again, this is from the Belarus Secret, Belarus, by John Loftus, copyright 1982, Alfred A.